dying, Christ is death. Rising, Christ restored our life. Will come again. As in baptism, Joseph put on Christ, so in Christ may Joseph be clothed with glory. Here and now, dear friends, we are all God's children. What shall be has not yet been revealed, but we know that when Jesus appears, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. Those who have hope in these truths, purify yourselves as Christ is indeed pure. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, yet they shall live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. Jesus says, I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. Though I may have died, behold, I am alive evermore. And I hold the keys to both hell and death. Because I live, you shall live also. Good morning, beloved friends and family of the faith. We gather here in this sacred place, in this sanctuary, to celebrate the life of Joseph Aikins-Afful, a life well lived, a life fully lived, a life lived in faith, hope, love, trusting in the Lord, our risen Savior, Jesus the Christ, a life that modeled that faith in every aspect of his living. And so we gather here, though hearts may be heavy, and it is okay to grieve, but we come here in this sanctuary and in this house of worship to celebrate the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ and the hope that, yes, even our beloved Joseph is now resting eternally, resting peacefully, resting with all power in his hands, resting with his Lord and his Savior and with his family and his ancestors. And for that, we give thanks to God for that truth, for that reality, and for that hope that we all dream and aspire to be in as well. Friends, I invite you, as you are able, to stand as we begin our worship services at this time with our opening hymn.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Eternal God, we gather today to celebrate the life of our departed loved one, Joseph. We celebrate a life of love and integrity and grace, a life that was a legacy to those who remain. May this not only be a day of mourning, but a day of celebration for a life that touched us all. We celebrate the memories we all have. Praise you for the great company of all those who have finished their course of faith and now rest from their labor. We praise you for those dear to us, whom we name in our hearts before you. We especially praise you for Joseph, whom you have graciously received into your presence. To all of these, grant your peace. Let perpetual light shine upon them, and help us to believe where we have not seen, that your presence may lead us through our years and bring us at last with them into the joy not made with the hands but eternal in the heavens. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Friends, you may be seated in the presence of our Lord at this time. And I invite you all to prepare your hearts and minds to receive the reading of our scripture lessons. Our first one will be offered by Sister Marcia Gleckler.
Today's scripture is from Isaiah 43, verses 1 through 4. But now, thus says the Lord, he who created you, O Jacob, he who formed you, O Israel, fear not, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. You are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you, and through the rivers, they shall not overwhelm you. When you walk through the fire, you shall not be burned, and the flame shall not consume you. For I am the Lord, your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. I give Egypt as your ransom, Cush and Seba in exchange for you, because you are precious in my eyes and honored, and I love you. I give men in return for you, peoples in exchange for your life. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Now, friends, our choir will offer an anthem of praise at this time. Thank you. Our next scripture reading will be presented by Ms. Patricia Herman. Mrs. Herman isn't here today, but she has offered a video recording of her reading at this time.
The scripture reading is taken from Psalms 9, verses 1 through 7. I will be reading from the New International Version. I will give thanks to you, Lord, with all my heart. I will tell of all your wonderful deeds. I will be glad and rejoice in you. I will sing the praises of your name, O Most High. My enemies turn back, they stumble and perish before you. For you have upheld my right and my cause, sitting enthroned as the righteous judge. You have rebuked the nations and destroyed the wicked. You have blotted out their names forever and ever. Endless ruin has overtaken my enemies. You have uprooted their cities. Even the memory of them has perished. The Lord reigns forever. He has established his throne for judgment. May the Lord add his blessing to the reading of his word.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Amen. If you all don't know me, I do beckon, call, and respond. So if it's okay to respond to me. At this time, friends and family, we will have a time of witness and reflection. I invite those who will offer a witness and reflection to come forward. However, our first reflection will be offered by our lead pastor, Reverend Dr. Amy McCullough, who will offer her reflection by video here at this time.
Good morning. Greetings to Mary, Eunice, Nita, and all who gather today to celebrate the life of Joseph Aikins-Afful and commend him to God. I am the Reverend Amy McCullough. I serve as lead pastor here at Grace Church. And I come to you today to share a few words of witness about Joseph. I first met Joseph when he and Mary joined Grace Church in the winter of 2015. It was right after Christmas, and so as I introduced them to the congregation, I said in a lighthearted way that it would be easy to remember their names, Mary and Joseph. In the weeks and months and years to follow, when Joseph would attend worship, he would always greet me with his warm, easy smile, his twinkling eyes. And even when the visits that we shared changed venue and it was at his home or at the hospital, the warmth of his spirit would envelop me in. Joseph's faith was obvious. He welcomed our time of conversation. He asked for prayer. He loved the songs that accompany our faith. And so today we commend Joseph back to the God who created him, who loved him first, who holds him now in a dimension of this cosmos where death is no more, tears and crying and limitation are no more, where those who have been raised are whole and free, and move on to greater and greater strength in God's redeeming love. Amen.
It is a privilege to pay tribute to Joseph Aikins today. I want to explain how I happen to be in this position. My wife and I served as pastors of First Church of God of Baltimore for 20 years, and during that time, our lives intersected with Joseph and Mary Aikins' lives and their daughters, Eunice and Anita. You see, the church that I served was located on Sipple Avenue in Baltimore, just a block or so off Moravia Road, where the Aikins family lived, right where Moravia Road and Sipple Avenue intersect. So we were fellow church members and neighbors, and that gave a special flavor and meaning to our relationship. We were fellow church members, and not only in church life together, but as friends and neighbors, we shared. Those were happy years for me, and I like to think Joseph would share the feeling that we were blessed to be neighbors and friends. During those years, I could see Joseph and see him and the life he lived, the pride he took in his family, in his African heritage, in watching his girls grow up and take part and develop in the Sunday school program and youth programs of the church. How proud he was when his wife Mary would sing. And seeing those beautiful solos in the church's worship times. Joseph was just an honorable man, steadfast in his dedication and taking his responsibilities truly seriously. I know there was suffering and pain at times in those years as they went by, but I like to think Joseph would say it was worth it every bit. Glad for the way God blessed him. So be at peace now, Joseph. Be at home in the loving arms of the one who was with you all through the good and the difficult times, holding on to you and helping you make the best you could of every challenge that came along. Amen.
Good morning. My name is Archer, Harry Archer. I came from Tuskegee, Alabama in the summer of 1979. And I met Kofi through his mother-in-law, Dorothea Jordan. We've had 40 years, over 40 years of friendship. And I tell you, we never fought. We never had disagreement. Kofi was a proud man. And he was a humble man. I never called him Joseph to his face. He always called me Kwesi. Kwesi is a male born in Ghana on Sunday, and Kofi is a male born on Friday. When his mother passed, Kofi and his wife, Mary, went home for the funeral. So I asked my younger brother, Yofi, to visit them. The time Yofi visited, Mary was so tired that she was in bed. So Yofi only talked with Kofi. During that talk, Kofi used a phrase, Ghanaian phrase, Ayejo, which means it's hard. Life is not easy. So anytime Yofi, my younger brother, called me and we talk, he will ask, how is Wayejo? And when I told Kofi, he laughed. It was so funny. But he was a man with sense of humor. So it turned out that anytime we talk, he would tell me that when I talk with Yofi, why you Joe, I should send him his regards. When my wife passed over 14 years ago, Kofi was always there. He consoled me. He comforted me. He advised me. And we commuted to and fro to Washington, D.C. on my train. And that man had funny ways, and I enjoy being in his presence. 40 years of friendship, and I'm telling you, Kofi is the only Ghanaian friend and big brother that I have. I don't know what I'm going to do, but I know he is in a better place. May his soul rest in peace.
We thank God for those times of witness and reflections offered by our pastor, Reverend Hardy, and Brother Archer. At this time, we will invite Sister Wilson to come forward for our next scripture reading, followed by Adrian Sutton.
Good morning. I'm going to be reading from Psalms 121, verses 1 through 8. I lift up my eyes to the hills. From where will my help come? My help comes from the Lord who made heaven and earth. He will not let your foot be moved. He who keeps you will not slumber. He who keeps Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is your keeper. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun shall not strike you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from all evil. He will keep your life. The Lord will keep your going out and your coming in from this day on and from this time on forevermore. That's what ends the reading of the Word of God. Uncle Kofi, Deye, Yebefio.
Good morning. The gospel reading comes from John chapter 14, verses 1 through 4, followed by verses 27 through 31. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and I will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way to the place where I am going. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid. You heard me say to you, I am going away and I am coming to you. If you love me, you will rejoice that I am going to the Father, because the Father is greater than I. And now I have told you this before it occurs, so that when it does occur, you may believe. I will no longer talk much with you, for the ruler of this world is coming. He has no power over me, but I do as the Father has commanded me, so that the world may know that I love the Father. The Gospel of our Lord.
Members of the family, Mary, Eunice, Anita, friends gathered here today, guests and members of Grace Church, God's grace and peace be with each and every one of you. Today we gather here to pay tribute to Joseph Theophilus Kufi Aikins-Afful. A sincere man, a genuine man, a devoted husband, a loving, sincere, caring father, a kind-hearted family man, the kind of man whose warm and inviting personality drew others to him. He's the kind of man that, as I stand here this morning, Sister Mary and Eunice and Anita, I have to confess, I don't feel that equipped to really speak on Joseph. And you're probably wondering, well, Reverend, why do you not feel equipped to speak upon this man? The truth of the matter is, it's been about a year since I've joined this particular branch of Zion and been appointed as this branch of Zion's associate pastor. I came here in 2021 in the month of July, and when I arrived here, as most newly appointed pastors, be it associate or lead pastors, the first task we have is a very tall order. It's called getting to know your congregation. Getting to know all of your congregation. A challenge that I would submit to you was even more difficult given the fact that over the last couple of years we've suffered through this pandemic and have been socially distanced for quite some time. But I can remember back in July of 2021 as I entered the study where I call my office, I received a stack of cards and notes and well wishes upon my arrival. In the study, there was also a few past pictorial directories, membership directories, pictures of members of the church, both present and past. And then I also had a stack of prayer lists. And on that prayer list, there were two names that I thought were, as Reverend McCullough would offer, easy to remember. But when I read those two names at the top of the list, Mary and Joseph, at first glance I thought to myself, now, does this congregation every Sunday pray for the parents of Jesus? Talk about much devotion. But then I thumbed through one of the pictorial directories, I believe it was the 2015 directory, and there was a picture there. Yeah, it was that one. It was good to put a name to some faces. Didn't get a chance to see Joseph during those first few months. And I won't go into the details of that, but I did get an opportunity during those times to meet with Mary. And Mary and I have this way of greeting one another, kind of like a mother and a son. Even with all the social distancing, I found myself being a little bit more willing to allow Miss Mary to receive a hug and for me to even offer a hug. And during those early months, I would ask Miss Mary, how is Joseph doing? And she would tell me, he has his good days and he has his not so good days, Reverend. And we always made plans to arrange to go visit with Joseph, but again, with COVID, it was always difficult. And obviously, being a servant leader and pastor, the last thing I ever want to do is be responsible for causing someone to get sick when otherwise I could just avoid that contact at all. But as I stand here this morning, I confess to you that of the names that have been lifted up on our prayer list every single Sunday, the one consistent name that always stood at the top of the list was Joseph Aikins-Afful. Then around February of this year, Mary approached me after worship and she asked me if I could arrange to visit with Joseph. We discussed the request privately and we agreed to meet at the nursing home where he was residing at the time. And we began to set forth a routine where I would meet with Joseph as best as I can weekly, trying to avoid any appointments that he may have during the week, ensuring that he was up to the visit. But there was one request that I asked Mary. I don't know if you remember this, but I asked you, is there anything that I could bring to the nursing home that would make Joseph smile? And she said, yes, Reverend, can you bring some fruitcake? And I thought to myself, fruitcake, okay. My own memories of fruitcake caused me to wonder, okay, my dad liked fruitcake too, but I didn't really like fruitcake that much. But I asked her, what specific brand of fruitcake would be appropriate? And Mary shared the brand. It was Claxon fruitcake from the Claxon Fruitcake Company, individually wrapped. And so I thought to myself, okay, we got to figure out where these fruitcake are going to be found. And so I went on Amazon. Thanks be to God for Amazon. And I ordered a box of fruitcake for our friend Joseph. Meeting Joseph for the first time, I remember the conversation being likened to one might have meeting a stranger for the first time. I introduced myself to Joseph and I was greeted by a kind yet subtle smile. We exchanged a few pleasantries and then, of course, a few Q&As, questions and answers with one another. Joseph, for his part, was especially interested in how I found myself in the ministry to begin with. And we spoke about my call briefly. I told him about where I grew up, where I went to school, and where I worked both during seminary and following seminary. And then we talked about family. I shared with Joseph that I was a father of two daughters, and his face lit up. He said, I have two daughters too. I was like, I know. We pray for them every single Sunday. And then Joseph asked me an interesting question. He asked me, how are the people at Grace? Are they treating you well? And I told him, yes, sir, the people at Grace are treating me just fine, and I'm adapting just fine there. And, you know, I would love to have you there, but I also understand that you can't make it, but you are still family, Joseph. And as a minister, you're taught when you offer pastoral care and visitation to be brief and to avoid overtaxing the person that is being visited. And this was a practice that, as best as I could, I aimed to follow when visiting with Joseph. But though coming to the end of our first meeting, I asked Joseph if it would be okay I took the opportunity to just pray for him and to pray with him. And Joseph said, I'd really like that, Reverend. And so we prayed. And then I offered him communion And then I promised him, assured him, that I would visit with you as often as you would like it, as often as you need it. And I meant that. And then after debriefing Mary in our conversation, one of the challenges of being in a nursing home is they restrict the number of people that can go up to visit with one of their residents. And so Mary had to stay away and I had to go up, and there was only one visitor at the time. But Mary and I talked and we debriefed as we would normally do when we met. And I assured her, as often as you and Joseph need me, I will be here. Subsequent to those visits, Joseph and I would gather, and our conversations would not be as full as the first one, but there was one particular moment I can remember sitting with Joseph, and he had this look on his face, not a troubled look, but just a look. And I asked him, Joseph, what's wrong? And he's like, oh, nothing. I just want to be delivered. He petitioned to the Lord to deliver him. And at first I didn't really understand what he was asking, but I could appreciate his desire nonetheless. Deliver me, Lord. The psalmist declares in the 71st chapter of the book of Psalms, deliver me, O Lord, out of the hand of the wicked, out of the hand of the unrighteous. The word deliver comes from the Hebrew word palet. It means to bring about security, to cause an escape. Most people in Joseph's situation would have probably asked for healing. Some may have even asked for restoration of body, or perhaps even restoration of strength. But Joseph's petition was one desiring security, an escape. His petition was deliverance. Which begs the question, how do we find security, an escape, deliverance in such an unstable, fragile, and insecure world that we live in? A world filled with distress, disease, illness, and yes, even death. For Joseph, brief, temporary moments of escape came by way of music. And I love music. And so Joseph and I would occasionally, when he didn't want to speak, we'd just sit in his room. And I would curate playlists of praise songs and old traditional hymns and maybe even a few contemporary hymns that he may have not been familiar with, but yet he still listened to them. But there were two particular songs that I can remember Joseph wanting to hear, one of which I offered to him because it was one that I had grown up listening to with my grandmother. It's Mahalia Jackson's rendition of Precious Lord. Precious Lord, take my hand and lead me on and let me stand. I am tired, I am weak, and I am worn. Yet through the storm and through the night, lead me on into the night. Take my hand, Precious Lord, and lead me on. There was another song, of course, which was echoed and reminded by Sister Mary, entitled Gentle Servant, Gentle Shepherd, which was played as a part of our instrumental as we processed in. Gentle Shepherd, come and lead us, for we need you to help us find the way. Gentle Shepherd, come and feed us, for we need your strength today. Each song shared in Joseph's presence offered a window into the kind and steadfast, immovable faith that I personally witnessed Joseph exhibiting each time I came and visited with him. The kind of faith that longed to see his parents again. The kind of faith that looked forward to the day when he would be in the company of his siblings and scores of family members and ancestors, now eternally resting in glory. The thing Joseph desired most was that he too would be delivered into that place of security, that eternal dwelling place. Now, this desire, of course, would not be void of the reality that Joseph would have to depart this world and those who would survive him. It would mean leaving behind his devoted wife of nearly 50 years. It would mean leaving physically behind his two daughters. It would mean physically leaving behind many family members and friends and loved ones that he has met along the way. It meant physically leaving behind a community who had grown accustomed to being in the presence and company of a man gentle in spirit, kind in heart, a man who embodied all that is good in this world, a humble man, a faithful man, a man who even in the 5 months that I was fortunate and privileged enough to sit in his presence, to sit at his feet, the kind of man that showed me that even in the hardest of times, the most challenging of times, there is a faith, there is a hope that is far greater than anything this world could ever offer to us. The kind of faith that our Lord calls each and every one of us to come into. The reality is that we all will face this moment in our short lives. For there is a day only known to the Lord when the angels will call us home as well. And saying goodbye to anyone that we love and cherish is difficult, no matter who the person is. No matter how close or distant that person may be. But it is especially difficult when one departing from us has played such an important part in our lives, be it a friend, be it a loved one, be it a parishioner, be it a neighbor. Jesus offers us truths concerning his eternal kingdom. And he gives us four truths that we hopefully will hold fast to as we in this moment mourn but yet celebrate a life well lived of our dear friend Joseph. Jesus offered a truth about his peace, his place, his promise, and his plan. Jesus's peace. In the face of trouble, Jesus invites us into his peace. As the scripture was read, we heard that Jesus says to his disciples prior to him departing, "Peace I leave with you. Peace I give to you. I don't give you the kind of peace that the world gives. So do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid." Beloved, if you find yourselves troubled today, maybe even want to cry, I'm here to tell you that it's okay. But I invite you to invite Jesus, our Lord, into that space, whatever emotions you may feel. Invite Jesus into that space. Jesus never promises to us that he would keep us from tough times. But Jesus does promise to give us his peace in the midst of all difficulty and all trouble. Sitting with Joseph the many times that I've had the privilege to, I can tell you that no matter what he was going through, he never complained. And we live in a world where people will complain about the weather. It's too hot outside. It's too cold outside. I don't like the way that person said something to me. It will not matter. But Joseph was not the kind of man, or at least not the kind of man that I witnessed, that ever had a moment where he complained. He desired forgiveness. He desired to be delivered. Joseph was the kind of man who knew that his Lord in heaven saw him for who he was. And as long as he was secure in that revelation, he didn't really care about how life treated him. Because he knew that his soul was anchored in the one who is able to deliver him, the one who is able to deliver us all. Joseph had that kind of faith. Jesus also shares with us the place that he has prepared for each and every one of us. For those who know the Lord, death is not the end. For Jesus has prepared for us a place in eternity for those who trust and believe in him. And this is good news, especially considering the fact that when we think about the place that Jesus has prepared for us, Jesus prepares a place for us even when his own life coming into this world, there was no room. Jesus was born in a manger of all places, didn't even have a home. But in eternity, the same Jesus who was born in humble beginnings has prepared a glorious kingdom for each and every one of us if we believe in him, if we place our hope and our trust in him. And the promise for those who have placed their trust in Jesus is that Jesus not only goes to prepare a place for us, but the promise is that Jesus will indeed come back and redeem us, come back and receive us, come back and deliver us. Being a man of faith that I am, I believe that as Joseph reached those final moments of his life, he was not alone. And I'm not talking about the doctors or the nurses or the attendants that were there caring for him at Good Samaritan. By faith, I believe that Jesus was there present with him, reminding him that he belongs to the Lord, assuring him that Mary and Eunice and Anita are going to be fine, that the place that Jesus has prepared for each and every one of us is ready for Joseph to enter into that eternal rest, a rest that transcends all of the cares of this world, the kind of rest that assures each and every one of us that the way we live in this life is not the way that we will live in the life to come. I think someone said it before, a life of no pain, a life of no tears, a life of no sorrow, but a life of infinite joy, a life of peace, a life delivered. And then, of course, finally, Jesus offers us his plan. in order to find the kind of peace that Jesus offers, to have the hope of the place that he has prepared for us, to receive the promises sealed in Jesus' own words. We are called to trust in his plan. Joseph trusted in the plan. Amen? Joseph believed in God's plan. Joseph lived his life as one believing, hoping, trusting, knowing that when the cares of this world pass by, there standing at the gates is our beloved Savior, our Lord, the one who goes forth to prepare a place for those who believe in him, but also the one who comes to receive each and every one of us when life comes and draws to an end on this side of glory. And in that, we can find peace and comfort still. Yes, today is a challenging day. Yes, leading up to this day has been trials and emotions felt by all, I could imagine. But the one thing I know for sure, brothers and sisters gathered here today, is that my friend Joseph, whom I've only had the pleasure of knowing for 5 months, the same man that I prayed for over the last year, he has been crowned with the promise of eternal life. Not because he was just simply a good man, but he was a good man. Not because he was nice to the people that he met, though he may have been nice to them. Not because he was just a devoted husband and a devoted parent, but because he put his hope and his faith in the promises of the Lord. And that's something to celebrate even in our mourning on this day. But the question that each and every one of us has to face right now, we all are aware that our lives will come to an end at some point. There is no question about that, amen? But the real question, brothers and sisters, today is, do you know the kind of peace that our friend Joseph knew even in his most trying of days? Do you know Jesus? Have you received Jesus as your Lord and your Savior? More than just a friend, more than just a good teacher, but he is the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, the one who holds the keys of heaven and hell in his hands, the one who is able to deliver each and every one of us. Do you know the Lord? If you don't know Jesus as your Lord and risen Savior, I invite you simply to consider him now. There is no promise, beloved, that we would see another moment, another hour, another day, another week, or another month. But one thing is for sure. Our lives here on this side of glory will come to an end. And the question each and every one of us will have to ask ourselves as those days approach, do we know where we're going when we leave this place? Friends, I just stopped by to tell you that I know where Joseph is. I hope to be where Joseph is when this life draws to an end. And I would even hope the same for each and every one of you. But the reality is, there's only one way, and that's through Christ. I invite you, if you have not already, to receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. Why wait? Why consider another moment? invites you to give yourself over to the Lord. Amen. Thank you, Patricia. I invite you all to pray with me at this time. Just wherever you are, just bow your heads in prayer. God of us all, your love never ends. When all else fails, you are still God. We pray to you for one another in our need and for all, anywhere who mourn with us today. To those who doubt, offer light. To those who are weak, offer your strength. To all who have sinned, provide us your mercy. And to all who are in sorrow, Lord, we ask that you offer peace. Keep true in us the love with which we hold one another. In all our ways, we trust you. And to you, with your church on earth and in heaven, we offer honor and glory now and forever. God's people said, amen. 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 O God, all that you have given us is yours. And as you first gave Joseph to us, we now give Joseph back to you. Lord, we ask that you receive Joseph into your arms of mercy. We ask that you raise Joseph up with all of your people. And we ask, Lord, that you receive us also and raise us into a new life. Help us so to love and to serve you in this world that we may enter into your joy in the world to come. Those who believe said amen. 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 And amen. Amen. And now, friends, and with the confidence that we are children of God, I invite each and every one of us to pray as our Lord taught us to pray. Beloved, we give thanks to God for allowing us the opportunity to gather here as people of faith to celebrate the life of our brother Joseph Theophilus Kofi Aikins-Afful, a life well lived, a life that now is in the heavens, watching us, even I would say petitioning for us, while we still find our time and place here on this earth. As we gather and prepare to leave this place, let us be reminded that there is still a family that grieves the loss of a husband, the loss of a father, an uncle, a friend. So as the weeks and months go by, I invite each and every one of you to keep them in your prayers. At holidays, birthdays, annual celebrations, remember this family. Call them. Send them cards. Visit with them. Tell them that you love them. That's what we do as people of faith. We love on one another. We hold one another up, even when it's hard. As we go from this place, but never from the presence of our Lord, let us be reminded that each and every one of us are called to make the same decision that Joseph made long ago. Will you follow Christ? I pray that Joseph's life and his legacy touched you, reminded you that there is a faith greater than this life. There is a hope that transcends this world. There is a reality even beyond the grave. And Joseph is free. And there is nothing that this world can do to hold him down any longer. And for that reason, we celebrate Joseph. This concludes our worship service. Hear now the benediction and blessing. May the grace and peace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with each and every one of you now and forever. Amen. Encourage the friends and family members as the family processes. Please remain in your seats until the immediate family has left the sanctuary. You all are invited to receive the family in our fellowship hall where a reception will be held for them. Please come by and pay your respects to the family. Amen. Amen. Amen.